what I like about the group program model is you can say, okay, you're in this program for a year and you can have digital access to just the videos, but like, we're not going to keep answering every question you have in the Facebook group for eternity.
Welcome to Sold with Webinars, a podcast that aims to uncover how the most successful experts, coaches, consultants, and e-course professionals sell their products and services with just one sales presentation or webinar. A simple sales webinar can transform the business and life of a solopreneur. And this podcast will show you how other experts just like you are generating six and seven figures per year online with their webinars. If you'd like to join our Facebook community where I share exclusive members-only content, join our Sold with Webinars Facebook group. For blogs, content, and information about our webinar services, visit thewebinaragency.com. And to download a free comprehensive six-month $466,000 webinar case study, go to soldwithwebinars.com. Now, let's get started. Hey, what's going on? Welcome to another very special episode of Sold with Webinars. Joel Irway here, and I've got a very, very special guest interview episode for you today. We are going to have an absolute blast. We're going to take a little bit of a different approach with this episode. I know we always like to try and be webinar marketing specific, but I wanted to try something a little bit different today because I have so many of you that are in the coaching and consulting and course creator space. I wanted to have a guest on, Mariana Ruiz, who is going to be talking about fulfillment today. Now, we haven't ever talked about fulfillment, but she's specifically going to be talking about her specialty. Let me give you a brief introduction about who Mariana is, and then we'll jump into today's episode. I know you're going to love it, but Mariana is a certified business coach and consultant and international best-selling author. She helps seasoned coaches and consultants scale their businesses by creating and launching their profitable group coaching programs. That's really why I want to be talking to her today and bring her onto this show. She uses her background in brain science, hospital administration, and 12 years of marketing, sales, and business experience to help you get results for your clients at scale. Market in a way that attracts your ideal clients and convert followers to group coaching clients through service-based selling. She's been featured in various podcasts, blogs, and online courses, including the Huffington Post, Today.com, and the Millionaire Insider Extravaganza. Through working with hundreds of businesses, she has empowered them to increase their profit and serve more people all over the world with group coaching. You can catch her podcast, the Impact Driven Entrepreneur podcast, on her site, impactdrivenentrepreneur.com, iTunes, Stitcher Radio, iHeartRadio, or Google Play. Mariana, welcome to the show.
Hi, Joel. Thanks so much for having me.
So we chatted briefly before our interview today, and one of the main things that got me interested was this idea of, you know, not the idea of group coaching programs. I'm familiar with group coaching programs, but you'd mentioned that you do group coaching programs slightly different than what most people may be, you know, may be aware of. Why don't you give us a little bit of introduction and a little bit of background about what we're talking about here, what we're going to be talking about.
Yeah. So how I teach group programs is not just let's do like a 6 week or 12 week group program. What I found when I was trying to scale my business from one-on-one model to a one-to-many model with a group coaching program is that with that short of a cycle and the way that I was selling it, I was basically going on this income roller coaster. So I either would have had to be like launching all the time, or I was going to have to change the way things were. And then the other part of it on the fulfillment piece is, especially in coaching, change takes time, right? So when I looked at like what my clients were doing in 2-3 years working with me, when they would renew and renew and renew, it was a stark difference to the clients that were working with me for one short period. So I started to look at how can I serve these people better by giving them a chance to change and like really helping them to not only apply the knowledge base at one level, but like really integrate and become that person that they're looking to embody, if that makes sense.
Yeah, 100%. What is the difference that you found in applying these group coaching programs? Like, how is yours different than, you know, what's typically out there in the marketplace right now?
Yeah. So one of the main ways is we like to keep our group programs small. So our group programs are only around 25 people, and each person gets an accountability coach as well as some time with me every quarter. So what I found is people were coming in at different areas. There's another huge difference. This is like from the hospital background, right? So when a patient comes into your office, you're not just going to diagnose them like the same thing you're going to give everybody, right? We need to like do an assessment and intake and see where they are. And then from there, we assess and say, okay, these are the next steps for you. So I do that with every single client coming in. And I think that that gives them like that much more customized way and their own way. Now, as far as scale, that's where it's like, okay, the leader, you would have to have, you know, your own coaches that you're like preparing and getting ready so that they can do the intake process and streamline that intake process. And that's what we're working on. So I have an accountability coach that works with all of the clients, and she's starting to understand, okay, when they come in with this, this is what we're doing, and like that kind of thing.
Okay, cool. So your model is really, it's more custom than say everyone has a certain start point and, you know, this is the progression path, you know, because you realize that people are going to be coming in different entry points, right? Mm-hmm. So you have that intake, you diagnose where they are, and then what happens? Like once you diagnose like where they are, like how do you send them in the right direction? Like in terms of, I'm sure you have tons of content, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, what does that look like once you are able to diagnose where they currently are?
Yeah. So when they come in, they get pointed. The first thing we do is a one sheet. It's basically like your entire business on one sheet. Sorry, but that was like the best way to have people really like stay focused, because, you know, entrepreneurs, we lose focus a lot. So the one sheet keeps their whole business on one sheet. And we create that for the next 90 days in terms of how they're selling, what their focus is, what are the assets they might have to build or create. So that's the main thing. And then from there, they go to the knowledge base. So they're referred to, the, like you said, all the content. So if they're in startup mode, we're going to say, okay, you need to go into startup school and start looking at those videos and start creating those assets that you need for that quarter.
Okay, cool. So I think where this is really... where the light bulb moment's coming on for me is I've been parts of lots of group programs where the content is in sequential order, meaning like everybody starts here and then you go to week one, week two, week three, week four, week five. And with yours, it's really more of a, you have a content hub and you are directing them to the right stage in their business. So there probably is a sequential path, like more of stages, right? Mm-hmm. It's more like, okay, in this stage you go here, in this stage you go here, in this stage you go here. Am I understanding that correctly?
Absolutely. Yeah, there's definitely like, so my methodology has stages, but where they're coming in may be more advanced, maybe more in the beginning. So instead of running everyone through the same program, I mean, we are, but we're just starting them where they are instead of starting them at square one if they don't need to like go back to square one.
Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. So what about the support? Like you said, everyone gets an accountability coach. Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Do you offer like group calls? Like what makes this a group program still? I mean, is there more involved with the fulfillment of this?
Yep. Every week they get a group coaching call in a group setting with us. And then once a month they will have an accountability call with their accountability coach as well.
Okay.
And so there's of course like Facebook group and all of that too.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. Okay. So they still have a community that they can connect with, right?
Mm-hmm.
One of the things that I've always wondered is how to run an effective group coaching call. Is this really just a Q&A session? Because if they're in different stages of their business, do you ever find that there's a disconnect with the members inside of, we've got X number of members who are in phase one, X number of members who are in phase two, X number of members who are in phase three, and they're all coming together on the group coaching call. Do you find that causes, I mean, number one, what is the group coaching call? How do you structure that? Maybe we should start there.
Yeah. So within the group, there's times where there's more teaching required and there's times where there's more coaching required. Mm-hmm. And so what I do is I hold classes where I do teach. So it might be like every Tuesday for the next month, we're going to be working on launching. So everyone's going to be going through launching and we're teaching, and then you're asking specific questions on launching. And then I have another call where it's just hot seats, like open questions. You can come in with any question at all. So not to be really confusing, but I like to think of it in two ways. Like you can structure it as more of a teaching call with some, you know, Q&A at the end, or you can just structure it as an open hot seat. And like you said, sometimes with open hot seats, somebody is way advanced and somebody is brand new and the questions are totally different. But usually, and especially with coaching, and if they're getting in their own way, what I find is that if the problem is emotional or like something along those lines, like they're afraid and all of that, like those kinds of emotional questions are always pretty much across the board. Like it doesn't matter if you're doing your first Facebook Live or you're afraid of like something else, like, you know, hiring an employee and having somebody that you have to pay a paycheck to, right? Like that same, if we're focusing on the coaching elements and like that emotional piece, we're addressing the fear, which is like the same across the board. But if they're asking more of a technical question, it's more, obviously more teaching required.
Awesome. How has this become more effective for you? Or was this the only model that you came up with or that you started out with? Or was this kind of like an evolution? Like, did you evolve to what you are at right now?
No, total evolution, like lots of failure and tears. I first like filled up one-on-one. I had 15 one-on-one clients. I had 2 kids under 2, no nanny, and a part-time VA. So I was like, whoa, I was like dying. And so I was like, I need to scale. And I couldn't, it was so strange in this weird phase when you have kids like this, because we couldn't afford like the daycare cost. And also like, I mean, where we are in New York, it's $2,500 a month for daycare, right? So it's like, okay, I could bring on an employee or I could pay for daycare. Either way, like it was just this weird dichotomy. So I was like, let me just scale back my hours so that I can actually enjoy my kids, right? Mm-hmm. And so that's how I ended up working it that way. And I tried courses, I tried membership sites, and eventually ended up with group coaching as my model. But the first group program that I ran was only, I think it was only 3 months. And it was this weird thing that happened is, first of all, I was launching with challenges. So for me to do a challenge, it required me this like huge runway of time and energy. And like, it felt like a lot riskier and I couldn't do it as sequentially enough to be able to raise the income enough. So by extending the term, not only was I helping the client, but I was also then creating recurring revenue in the business.
What do you mean by extending the term?
So what I ended up doing, we tried with running the group program for a 6-month contract, a 9-month contract, and a 12-month contract. And we have found the best with the 12-month. So the person comes in, they're in for a whole year. It's a year-long program. Mm-hmm. So for the business, what that means is like, I can pretty much keep launching and increasing the revenue without having to like replace any churn that happens in the business. Mm-hmm. So that has been really helpful for us. And for the client side, I mean, we have multiple clients that have 400x their income, you know, because we give them the time. Yep. Does that make sense? Like, you know, I can't promise you like overnight success in 6 weeks. Like it's just not how I work and how the things that you're going to try, right? For it to be like sustainable and really stand the test of time, we need time, right? Mm-hmm. So that has worked for both sides for us.
How were you able to successfully transition from one-on-one to group? Meaning, did you approach your one-on-one clients and say, hey, listen, I need to convert this to a more scalable way? And how did that conversation go with them?
Yeah. So I started just including them in the group and being like, there are things that I'm teaching you on these one-on-one calls that could benefit other clients. And so I started including them in the group. And then over time, I just, you know, offered it less and less and less. And I still offer it like when I will do a launch, I actually launched a group version and including some one-on-one. And so what that does is it helps me to get, you know, still like the higher tier, but it also anchors the price, right, of the program on the sales page. So that's a great plus bonus right there. Mm-hmm. And I enjoy one-on-one, so I don't want to ever completely get rid of it, but I don't want 15 one-on-one clients. That's too much. Oh, I hear you.
I was in the same boat. I had gone back and forth for a while of like, do I want to do one-on-one? Because I loved it. Like, I really did like one-on-one, but then it's like, they're pinging me all the time. And I started to feel some resentment, and I didn't want to feel any resentment towards my clients because I never set up those boundaries with one-on-one. It was just like, okay, cool. Hit me up whenever you want. And it was like the worst model possible.
Yeah. Yep.
Easy to sell, but horrible to fulfill on, you know, on any sort of scale. So it doesn't sound like you lost any retention when you converted your one-on-ones to group. You actually probably added value to them, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And we had a few people stay even longer because they had that community aspect. Like when I was coaching them one-on-one, they felt they were the only ones having, you know, the fears and like that emotional piece. And then they found the community to be so helpful and like, wow, I'm not alone, you know? So that was cool.
Yeah, that's fantastic. So now you can have, you know, the benefits of this are what? Rolling enrollment. So you can enroll people anytime, right? Mm-hmm. You establish a community, you establish leverage for yourself, and you establish scalability. How big is your fulfillment team? So you said you've got accountability coaches. Like, how many accountability coaches do you have?
Right now I have one, but she's like running out of hours. So we're actually hiring somebody else to come in and do that.
Okay. So how many can one person handle, would you say, with this model?
It depends on how many hours you offer and what else they're doing. So that person is also doing billing and other things. So it just depends, but I don't know exactly. Like, it would just have to depend on how much you offer for the program. Yeah.
Okay, cool. I love talking about this because there's so many different ways to run a group program, both good and bad. And so when you are, can we talk about how this is framed, how this is positioned when you sell it? Like, let's talk about the marketing, the sales piece, right? You know, when you sell a year-long group program, how do you recommend positioning that?
Yeah. So how we position it is like, this is A through Z, everything you need to go from zero to multiple six figures in your business. So that's like A through Z is basically how we sell it. Mm-hmm. And I also position it in terms of like, we're not building a Frankenstein business. So like what I found was a lot of people would come in and they would have like one piece. They'd be like, okay, you know, like I do sales calls or I do Instagram really well, but then there were like, they're not looking at their numbers. They're not like, you know, hiring a team. They're like, all these other pieces were kind of array. And so my background is in corporate, right? So that's really my top strength, is in like building a company. So bringing those aspects like into the business really helped them to like round out what they were doing.
Have you ever found that when you were pitching this? So for me, like in the world of like, you know, signing on to a year-long commitment, like that's a long time. That's actually like, so for me, like I would have to think about that long and hard, like if I can make that long commitment. Do you find many objections with positioning it? Because you said you have much higher retention when you frame it as a year-long engagement versus something shorter. Mm-hmm. Do you find many objections with that? And I guess on the sales piece, the marketing, the sales piece?
Yeah. So we started really like getting into the groove with that long-term in December. And I always do like a survey at the end of the launch. And I say like, hey, tell me like what you need or what happened, you know, like, why didn't you buy? And we had some people say like, the term was too long. For the phase that I'm in my business, it was too long. So we actually just launched a 3-month program that's helping them just to launch the group program, like get their group program off the ground, like you know, and it was just that one piece of the launching and the selling of the group program and the structure of the group program. And I was shocked at how poorly that launched it. I was like, this launch has gone horribly wrong. And it was like exactly what they had asked for after the last launch of, you know, the longer term program. So I'm still figuring out like what it is that's not working with, like what it is that they really want in terms of the shorter term program. But we do have other shorter terms programs that we'll sell into, and then they will upsell. So we do like at the end of the launch, we'll do a 2 month like mindset program. And from there we have upsells into the other programs. So still trying to figure out like exactly what that shorter term program would be that like feeds into the longer term. Because I know that once they start working with us, they want to continue. So it's just a matter of like figuring that out. But it wasn't overnight that we were like, this is going to be a 1 year long program. Like it took a lot of time and launches to like get there.
In what you teach, like, are you going to recommend for everybody that they do a year long program? Or is what you teach really just kind of like how to operate and structure the group program? And the term length is kind of, they have to figure it out on their own. What depends with their market?
It does depend on the market, but also what I really want them to focus on, because what we're really doing there is building that recurring revenue base. So they could do it with a one-on-one program if they wanted to or whatever. But what I want them to really look at is the run rate of their business and decide like, and really be strategic with their launching and how they're selling so that they're not just playing catch up on like trying to keep, you know, fill the clients that they just lost, right? Like, are we upselling? Are we, what are we doing to keep that like run rate going at a nice steady rate?
So what is the upsell at the end of that first term, that first engagement? Is it just ongoing support? Are they just paying for continued access at the end of their group program? Or is there something else that we should be considering?
I think every business is a little bit different. What we found is they get to a point where they actually need higher level strategy and more like the leadership and the hiring managing side. So we are doing a mastermind now. So that's going to offer that. And before I was just fulfilling that in one-on-one. So once they would finish the group program, they would go on into one-on-one coaching and we would do more leadership coaching with them on that.
Very cool. What else am I missing, you know, with what coaches and consultants are struggling with in the world of fulfillment?
The main thing I think is like how, like, and I know you've talked about this before on the show, because I listen to the show, I love the show. But like being really intentional about how you're fulfilling on it. So you're not serving all these clients, like a lifelong client that paid you once a year ago or 3 years ago. You know what I mean? Like what I like about the group program model is you can say, okay, you're in this program for a year and you can have digital access to just the videos, but like, we're not going to keep answering every question you have in the Facebook group for eternity. So that kind of thing is really important because, you know, not everybody has the bandwidth, right? Like we have a person that is solely in charge of that community. And so we're paying for that person now. And if we're not bringing revenue in to cover that, like it can get really, really messy fast.
Yeah. I think it's important to understand, you know, because you really do need the right pieces in place to cover the expenses and, you know, having a team to fulfill and having a team to help manage this entire process frees up your own personal bandwidth. But it's also important to know that you have to have those consistent sales coming in, consistently getting new people in there, because you're going to have churn and you're going to have drop off. But what would you say has been the biggest retention piece inside of your group program? Like, what do you say is like that biggest lever that keeps people sticking around and increasing that lifetime value?
Definitely the community. So yeah. They lean on each other and they just help each other. So when they start, we set them up with accountability buddies, and a lot of times they'll just stay, you know, together the whole time. So that's huge.
So it's definitely the community. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we found that to be true as well. When we ran a group program, it was hard to kind of get that community started. But once they started to get active and they started to engage, I mean, they're answering each other's questions, which helps, but like then they also learn from each other. And so there's a lot of benefits in that. Yeah. So, okay. Awesome. Well, where can people connect with you? Where can people reach out to learn more about what you do? And, you know, if they're interested in launching a group program, you know, with what they offer, where can they learn more?
You can find us at impactdrivenentrepreneur.com. That's our website, and the podcast, Impact Driven Entrepreneur Podcast.
Awesome. Well, Mariana, it was fantastic to chat with you, another fellow upstate New Yorker. I know that you went to school. Well, you went to school just, you know, about half hour away from where I live, and so you know, it's not all that often that I get to connect with other fellow Buffalonians and Western New Yorkers. I know you're not here now, but you're still in upstate New York, but just a different part of the state. Appreciate you sharing all of your knowledge today. It was a fantastic conversation. Very, very interesting to learn how you run your group programs, how you structure the group programs in an effective, efficient manner. And if you're interested in running your own group program, group coaching program, I encourage you to please go check out her website, go check out her podcast, and just let her know that you heard her on Sold with Webinars. And we'll see you on the next episode. Take care.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks so much for listening. We hope you enjoyed today's episode, and we look forward to giving you the next one. For blogs, content, and information about our webinar services, be sure to visit thewebinaragency.com. If you'd like to download a free, comprehensive, six-month, $466,000 webinar case study, go to soldwithwebinars.com. And if you'd like to join our Facebook community, where I share exclusive members-only content, join our Sold with Webinars Facebook group. Finally, if you enjoy this content, be sure to give us an honest review on iTunes, Stitcher, or wherever you listen to podcasts. Join us next time, and I'll see you there.